Hello, everybody, and welcome to our discussion about telescopes. This will be a brief introduction to how telescopes work, a little bit of the history, and the pros and cons of different types of scopes. There's a whole lot about telescopes out there, but this will at least get us started. So, to begin with, all telescopes use some type of objective. An objective is either a lens or mirror that bends or reflects light. And we're going to start our discussion with lenses. Because they're a little easier to understand, and historically, they're what most scopes used before we transitioned to mirrors later on. So to begin with, remember, lenses are curved pieces of glass that bend light. Light comes into the lens in this model from the left-hand side, and all gets bent together at a focal point on the right-hand side. They allow us to gather light, they allow us to focus light, and mirrors do very similar things. But the problem is, a lens can't magnify something that's far away. Lenses only magnify things when they're relatively close to the objective. So here you can see there's a picture of a candle on the left-hand side between a focal length and two times the focal length. Well, the resulting image is an inverted image that is larger than the original. In other words, it's magnified. But if you take that same image of a candle and move it way out past two focal lengths, we don't get a magnified image. A single lens can't do this. And if you hold a lens up to the moon trying to magnify it, it doesn't work. If you recall from any time you've played with a magnifying glass, you have to get the magnifying glass pretty close to what you want to look at in order for it to magnify. So the only way we can really use lenses effectively is to use them together. We need to use multiple objectives in order to actually get what we're looking at. One of those objectives, the large one, which we typically call the primary objective, gets our light gathered up and gets that image gathered up and relatively close. Then our second one, we can manipulate it. We can magnify it. We can change it around. We can do some stuff with it. But again, the primary objective is the big one. That's literally the large one, and it's also the important one. And it's the one that gets that image up close to you. Then the secondary objective can do all your magnification. What you're literally doing with that primary objective is bringing the image up inside the focal length of the second one. Then in the second one, you can actually magnify it. So you have a real image behind the primary objective of a distant object that you can magnify using your second lens. But recall that telescopes aren't primarily there for magnification. The big thing they do is gather light. So lenses act a lot like buckets in the rain. A bucket in the rain will gather water, and there are a couple things that will affect the rate at which it gathers water. If it rains more, you'll get more water, and if the bucket's bigger, you'll get more water. Well, the same is true for lenses and mirrors with light. If the object is brighter, it's like it raining more, and you're going to get more light. But that's not something we can control. What we can control is how big the bucket is, or in other words, how big the objective is. So the bigger the lens or the bigger the objective, the more light we can gather. And once we gather that light, then we can magnify those objects. Magnification is pretty much all done in the eyepiece of scopes. These smaller eyepieces, somewhat counterintuitively, magnify more than the longer ones, but the magnification is done in these relatively small interchangeable parts that you put in scopes. Most of what's done with the scope is that primary objective, gathering light. Okay, so the first telescopes were developed by a contemporary of Galileo. He gets all the credit for it, and probably rightly so. Maybe he just stole it through good marketing. But what he did is he convinced the people around him to fund his building of telescopes by talking about their potential military purpose. You can imagine taking a scope from your port or from your seaside town like Venice, and you can shine that scope out on the horizon and wait for potential enemy ships, and you'd get an advantage if you could see them coming earlier. So he got funded. He built telescopes, and of course, he also used those scopes to observe the sky. But he was the first person to really get credited for using telescopes. He wasn't the first to design them, but he gets credit for it. And this is his design, or the design that he used. It uses a large primary mirror that's a convex lens or a converging lens to take that object, some distant bright object, and focus the light in towards a focal point, F there on the right. Now you'll notice before the light gets to that focal point, he uses a concave or diverging lens to actually split that light back out, and so it comes into your eye as an enlarged image. This works pretty well. Galileo was able to gather light of distant objects, magnify them, and you were able to see something. Another thing you'll notice is since the light never makes it through the focal point, the objects in Galileo's scope would be right side up. They haven't gone through the focal point and flipped over, so they're not upside down images. And from a military standpoint, you do want to see ships right side up, so that's probably a good thing. But there were some problems with Galileo's design. It had a really small field of view, sort of like looking in a tiny little tube at an object. Probably not the best from a military standpoint, but because of that, we had to come up with better scopes. He also had a pretty blurry image, and it wasn't the best you could imagine. But despite these limitations, he was still able to make these incredible discoveries like the moons of Jupiter pictured here, the phases of Venus, and so on. So it wasn't the best scope. I guess it was the best scope at the time because it was the only one. But since then, we've seen a lot of improvements in telescope design. And probably the first one was Kepler's changes. And Kepler, a few decades after Galileo, changed a little bit about the scope. And you'll notice a couple of things if you look at this graphic. It still starts with a big primary objective. It's a convex lens or converging lens. But the secondary objective is also a converging lens, or also a convex lens. Its location, if you notice, is beyond the focus. So the focal point here, where all the light crosses, remember Galileo's scope had the lens in front of that point. In this case, you have it behind that point. So again, you have a secondary is a converging lens, and it's also beyond the focus. And because of these two differences, you're going to see an inverted image. Since the light all passes through that focal point, it gets turned over and is upside down when the observer sees it. This design does fix most of Galileo's problems. You no longer have that really restrained field of view. The image is a little bit crisper, but yes, the image is upside down. Now, in astronomy, we don't really care if the image is upside down. Doesn't matter if you're looking at Mars right side up or upside down, it's just Mars. And so most astronomers just work with this type of a scope, and it works pretty well for getting you an image, even though it inverts the image. This type of scope, this refracting telescope, again using lenses, is the modern day refractor, and it's what we've used ever since. Really, we don't use Galileo's design much anymore. Typical refracting telescopes, really they fall into two categories. Either they're these nice old school traditional type scopes like the one pictured here on the left, that's a replica of Galileo's scope, or they're relatively cheap scopes you could buy at Walmart. If your grandma hears you're taking an astronomy class, chances are she's going to buy you that $80 refractor at Walmart with a 2-inch objective and a whole bunch of parts that can get broken. But that said, they're neat scopes. There are some amazing refractors out there, but for the most part, they tend to be either older designs or they tend to be cheaper designs. There are some scopes that are typically refractors that people use on a regular basis, and they're spotting scopes. Spotting scopes, whether it's a rifle mount and you have the scope on your rifle, or a scope for bird watching, or a pair of binoculars, those are all refractors. One of the issues with refractors, though, and the design that we talked about, is you get this inverted image. And we don't want that inverted image. So all of these scopes need to have a solution to that. And here's a ray diagram of a typical spotting scope looking at an image off to the right. And you'll notice the light, just like we talked about before, the light passes through the focus and it gets inverted at that secondary objective, that second lens. So how do they deal with it? Well, they add another lens, and this other lens just flips the image back over. And you can do that. You can flip images over and over again every time you add a lens. Now, when you add a lens, not all of the light gets refracted. Some gets reflected, and you lose a little bit of light. So astronomers don't add these extra lenses. They'd rather have the light than have a right-side-up image. But when you're talking about bird watching or hunting or something, you probably want that extra lens. There are, of course, historically some very large telescopes that were also refractors. And probably the most famous two are Lick and Yerkes. Lick was built in the late 1800s by, funded by the benefactor James Lick. James Lick had a lot of money and didn't have much to do with it when he was dying, and so he had a whole bunch of different ideas what to do. One of his ideas was to build a great big pyramid in downtown San Francisco. Another one was to build a statue of himself, but thankfully some scientists got a hold of him and convinced him to build Lick Observatory. Lick Observatory was built in the late 1800s. He donated about $700,000 to this, which in today's money is the equivalent of about $1.3 billion, to have this amazing scope built. The mirror was ground in Boston and then carried across on trains and stagecoaches and mule carts all the way up to the top of Mount Hamilton and placed in this amazing observatory. Lick is buried beneath it. He didn't live to see the actual construction of the scope, but in its day, it was the largest scope in the world. The number here of 36 inches is an important number, and we're going to continue to talk about this. This is the size of the objective. So this is just under a meter. For modern day scopes, it's not very big, but it's certainly important at the time and certainly the biggest refractor in its day. And that's Lick, just a beautiful, beautiful scope owned by the University of California. The largest refractor that still exists in the world is Yerkes in Wisconsin. It's a little bit larger than Lick. It was built a little bit after Lick, but it is no longer in operation. So Lick is the still functioning observatory that you can still see. You can go visit it. They have tours. It's a really neat scope. But you'll notice, of course, if you look at both of these scopes, is they were built in the 1800s, and it's not like astronomy stopped in the 1800s. The thing is, we changed from these refractors to reflectors. And the reason we did that is because of three primary problems with refractors. So to begin with, the first big problem with refractors is these lenses get exceedingly hard to support. Remember, they're convex lenses. They're thick in the middle and thin on the edges. And as you have a very thick piece of glass that's thin on the edges, it's like putting a big piece of glass on an exceedingly large trash can. At some point, as that trash can gets bigger, you're supporting this very, very thick piece of glass by these thin little edges, and the glass can actually bend and potentially break. So you can only make your scope so big before it collapses in on itself. So this is a bit of a problem with refractors. You can only get so big before they start to fall on their own weight. Well, one solution or way to mitigate this problem is to get relatively thin lenses, and this helps the problem. But the problem is when you have a thin, thin lens, it tends to have a really long focal length, which gets to our second problem with refractors, is their focal lengths tend to be really, really long. And so for a relatively small objective, you end up with this really, really long tube, which can be somewhat impractical. And so looking back at these two famous observatories, the focal length of Lick is 58 feet, and the focal length of Yerkes is 62 feet. One of the solutions to this problem is as you're moving the scope around, some old refractors had a little cage on the back that the astronomer would hang around in. Other ones, like you can see pictured on the right with Yerkes, there's ladders that go up to the scopes. So you move the ladder up when you're looking at one object and you move it down when you're looking at others. But it's a big problem because you got this giant tube and you got to get to the back of it to see stuff. Lick has a pretty creative way of dealing with it. So you imagine if you're looking at something on the horizon with Lick, and then you want to look at something that's up above. Well, what Lick does is it actually lowers and raises the floor. The floor is on hydraulics. And so you're able to see objects that are down at the horizon with that floor raised and with objects up higher with the floor lowered down. So there are ways to get around this, but it still is a lot of work for these really relatively small scopes looking at these very distant objects. And the last problem with refractors is called chromatic aberration. And chromatic aberration is actually a really cool thing. When you shine light through a medium, different wavelengths of light refract different amounts. That's why this Dark Side of the Moon poster here, or album cover, shows you the light coming in from the left, and as it goes through the prism, the red wavelengths don't bend as much as the purple ones do, and so we get a rainbow out the other side. This is why we get rainbows. When light shines through water droplets, we see that same effect. Red doesn't bend as much as blue does, or purple does, and so we see a rainbow. Well, why is this a problem for scopes? Well, it's the different wavelengths then effectively have different focal lengths. A red wavelength is going to bend less than a blue wavelength. So if you get your red in focus, the blue is not in focus, and vice versa. So you can't really focus your just basic refractor on any one color. There are ways to deal with this. You can put little coatings over your lenses that diffract different wavelengths a little bit, and that can help. But in the long run, this is a problem that you have to deal with refractors too. So you can only get so big, you have chromatic aberration, and you have these really long focal lengths. So with those three main problems, modern telescopes are almost exclusively mirrors. or almost exclusively reflectors. So there are some really amazing scopes that are reflectors, and we're going to get to that, but we need to start by talking about how these work. So reflectors, of course, are easy to support. They don't have any chromatic aberration, and therefore they can be much, much bigger, gather more light, and there's a whole bunch of benefits to them. But there is at least one really obvious problem. So imagine light coming into this converging or concave mirror here. When the light comes in, it bounces off and comes to a focal point in front of the mirror. So all the light comes in at this point, but if you want to see it, you have a problem. Imagine standing in your bathroom and trying to look at something directly behind you through a mirror. Problem is, you're in the way. And this is true in astronomy too. In astronomy, you got to put your big old head right there to catch that image. And with your big head there catching that image, you're going to block the image you're trying to look at. So the fact that the image appears in front of the objective as opposed to behind is one of the biggest problems of reflectors. And there are a couple of solutions to this problem. One, developed by Isaac Newton, is what we call the Newtonian reflector. And what it does is it puts a secondary mirror at about a 45-degree angle. What that allows you to do, when the light comes in, it bounces off the primary, then the secondary, and gets shot out the side at that angle. From there, you can put in another eyepiece, and you can observe your object out the side. This, again, is called a Newtonian reflector and was developed by Isaac Newton. And it is an effective way to bend and move light using mirrors. Most scopes you find, if you look at, you know, Meade or Celestron or any of the main companies that sell scopes, nearly all of their reflectors are going to be Newtonian reflectors. It's a simple design and it works pretty well. The other type of design, the other basic design, is to use a mirror that's flat to the primary mirror and put a hole in that primary mirror. This way, the light bounces off, comes to that secondary mirror, and then shoots right back through the hole in the middle of the primary. You can put your eyepiece back beyond that and you can see this. This has a design that looks from the outside a lot more like a refractor because the resulting image ends up behind the primary objective. This is called a Schmidt-Cassegrain design and it's also really effective. A lot of scopes nowadays, a lot of the larger telescopes, won't do all of this. They'll just use, instead of a secondary mirror, that's where they'll actually capture their image. They'll sort of stand in front of it, as it were, and put whatever computer device right there instead of a secondary image to capture. So one of the main problems here is that this secondary objective is in front of your primary objective and does block some of the light. So it's not a world-ending problem. You just lose a little bit of the light that you would get otherwise. The second problem is also not gigantic, but it is a real problem, especially as your objective gets larger. Mirrors and lenses, in order to refract or reflect light exactly to the same focus, need to actually be shaped like parabolas, like this one pictured here. Parabolas have an ever-increasing slope as you move away from the center point. And this is great theoretically and mathematically to have a parabola, but it's really, really hard to shape something as a parabola, to mathematically gradually increase the slope of your grinding when you're continuing a mirror or a lens is really, really hard. It's almost impossible to make a perfect parabola. So nearly all scopes use spheres instead, like the one pictured here to the right. So a parabola or a parabolic mirror would be perfect. It would have a focus that's exactly where you want it. But spherical mirrors, as you get farther and farther out to the edge, becomes more and more of a problem. They have their own focus. They don't bend the light enough, or they bend it too much, as it were. And so the problem is we don't get perfect parabolic mirrors. The bigger the mirror gets, the more this is an issue. This does happen with lenses too, but typically they don't get big enough for this to be a problem. And in reality, if you bought a telescope, this wouldn't be a problem with the size of a mirror you'd be considering. But as the mirrors get bigger and bigger, spherical aberration is a bit of a problem. But one we're still willing to deal with when we start talking about these very, very large scopes. So let's talk about some of the primary reflectors out there in the world. The most famous back in the day was, of course, Mount Wilson. Mount Wilson was a 100-inch reflector, so way bigger than the refractors that it replaced. It was built in 1924 in California, and huge discoveries were made with this telescope, ones that you can research and learn about As we'll talk about those things a little bit later. But this scope really opened our eyes to some new stuff in astronomy that wasn't available for Lick and Yerkes. Beyond Mount Wilson, a few decades later, was the giant Hale scope, built in 1949, which doubled the diameter, which increases the size of the scope and the actual collecting area by a lot more. This scope was revolutionary and was an incredible scope in the 1950s. Again, great big discoveries have been made in astronomy using Palomar or Hale, also in California. So both of these scopes, very, very important historically, and scopes continued to get bigger throughout the next several decades. The largest scopes right now, the very largest single mirrors, there's one on top of Mauna Loa in Hawaii. It's an 8-meter mirror. So you can think about the size of a gigantic mirror. 8 meters in diameter is an incredibly large mirror and takes a lot of engineering to make it and to carve it to the right shape. Problem is, at some point, mirrors just get so darn big, it's hard to move the darn things around. We can see lots of good stuff with them, but at some point, getting a giant, giant mirror to the top of a mountain is still a problem. Developed by a physicist and astronomer in the 80s, a gentleman named Jerry Nelson came up with a really unique design. And that design was first used on Keck Observatory. And the Keck Observatory also sits on the top of Mauna Loa in Hawaii. And it's actually two telescopes. That's not the revolutionary part. The revolutionary part is the mirror design itself. But these are two 10-meter mirrors that can actually work together. It's an amazing telescope, and for a long time has been the most powerful optical scope on the Earth. What it does is it uses this honeycomb-like design, where you use a whole series of effectively 1-meter mirrors and bring them all in together to resolve one image. The one image, you'll notice, you can see the picture of the person on the bottom. It's sort of that secondary scope, the one sitting out in front of it, is actually catching the image and then communicating that information back to the astronomers. So they don't actually reflect it through a hole in the middle, they just catch it right there. But it's an amazing scope, very effective, and these two scopes together do an amazing job of getting us a lot of light. Keck's probably the most famous telescope you haven't heard of, and it's done a lot for us in our country. It's not the biggest optical scope in the world. The Gran Telescopio is actually a little bit bigger. This telescope's in Spain, and is a fantastic scope as well, and much more modern in many ways than the Keck. And finally, probably the one telescope you have heard of, if you've heard of any scopes, is this one, the Hubble. Hubble is an amazingly powerful telescope, not because of the size of its mirror. You'll notice it's only 2.4 meters. It's the same size as some of those early telescopes we talked about, but its huge advantage is it's in space. And being in space allows it to not deal with the Earth's atmosphere and light pollution. And because of that, it's made incredible discoveries. It's probably the most important functioning telescope that's been built ever. And it's a good 30-year-old scope, but it was a very effective scope. It was actually, when it was launched, was out of focus, and they had to send a shuttle crew up to actually fix it. And once they got it into focus, it sent back incredible images ever since. But everything we've talked about so far are all studying visible wavelengths of light. And visible wavelengths, if you recall, are only a small fraction of all of the wavelengths of the electromagnetic spectrum. You can go all the way from the long ones like radio waves to the very short ones like gamma. And we can look at objects in any of those wavelengths. We just need different devices to do it. Here on Earth, we have a couple of giant radio telescopes. Probably the most famous is the VLA, or the Very Large Array in New Mexico. And this scope uses 25-meter dishes that can be spread in or out to make a resolved scope as big as 36 kilometers. All of the scopes are on these little railroad tracks, and they can pull them in and spread them out to get different types of images. Recall that radio waves are really long waves. They can be kilometers across, and so they're very big waves. And so depending on what you're looking at, we can spread in or bring these out. Radio scopes are really important because they allow us to see very, very distant, very, very old objects because those radio waves pass through media better than other waves. So we can see a lot with these scopes like the VLA. The VLBA, the Very Long Baseline Array, is the same idea. It uses a whole bunch of radar dishes, but it has a resolved diameter of 8,600 kilometers because it uses scopes stationed all over North America. So it's an incredible scope when you use all of these together. The VLA and the VLBA can see different stuff, but all in the radio wavelengths. Now, if you think about things on the other end of the spectrum, things that are very, very short wavelengths, well, those wavelengths typically don't get to Earth. They get scattered by our atmosphere. But we do have scopes that are designed to observe them. They're just in space. And probably the most famous one is Chandra. And Chandra is an X-ray telescope that was launched in the late 90s, and it's got a 1.2 meter objective. But it observes distant objects in the X-ray range. And we also have other X-ray scopes as well as gamma ray scopes in space that all observe these different things. Well, hopefully something you've noticed in looking at all of this information is that all of these scopes are built in, with the exception of the Gran Telescopio built in 2008, none of them are even built in the 2000s. Many of them are 20, 30, or more years old. So where's the new scope? I mean, if Hubble is so amazing, why haven't we built an upgrade to Hubble in the last 30 years? You think about all the upgrades in technology on Earth in the last 30 years, that we didn't even have cell phones 30 years ago, and now we can take pictures and surf the internet with our phones. Why haven't we made changes to scopes? Well, we have. We've built and shot up a whole bunch of different scopes over the last few years, but really none that have had the impact of the ones we've talked about. There is, however, one scope on the horizon that really is exciting astronomers, and it's the James Webb. The James Webb Space Telescope is hoping to revolutionize our understanding of astronomy. It's supposed to be maximized in the infrared, so a little bit off of visible light, and it's going to be a phenomenal scope once it finally gets launched. Its launch date has been pushed back for a while now, but really hoping that it gets a chance. I'm going to show you this quick video on it, and then we will call it a day.
This is your telescope, an engineering marvel, an exploration powerhouse. Use it to look back in time and explore the first galaxies that formed after the Big Bang, to peer into atmospheres of planets orbiting the stars. It's your eyepiece to the uncharted, unknown, and unimagined. This is the largest, most complex, and challenging space telescope ever constructed. It will change our understanding of the universe and our place in it. The James Webb Space Telescope. Equipped with the largest primary mirror ever to be flown in space, at 6.5 meters, it's more than 6 times the size of the Hubble Space Telescope primary mirror. Webb's 4 cutting-edge infrared instruments and cameras operate at super cold temperatures, temperatures colder than the surface of Pluto. Getting this cold is done with the help of the largest sun shield ever flown, a 5-layer, tennis court-sized sun shield that blocks heat from the sun, Earth, and moon. Webb will be the first telescope to detect light from the most distant galaxies in the universe. These first galaxies formed about 13.5 billion years ago, only 300 or so million years after the Big Bang. Webb carries advanced technologies to tackle some of the most fundamental questions about the universe. How did the first galaxies form and evolve? Are there chemical signatures of the building blocks of life on other worlds? Is our solar system unique? Launching such a large telescope into space is an incredible engineering challenge. Fully deployed, Webb is too large to fit inside any rocket fairing. Engineers designed it to be folded, like origami, to squeeze inside the European Space Agency's 5-meter diameter Ariane 5 rocket fairing. After launch, controllers on the ground deploy Webb remotely. Deployment is an intricate ballet. For nearly 3 weeks, controllers carefully unfold Webb. After this delicate dance, Webb's golden mirrors are precisely aligned using motors behind each hexagonal mirror segment, adjusting them to form one perfect mirror. Once the instruments are fully cooled, the exploration will begin. Webb is a technological challenge like no other, born of the efforts of thousands of people across the United States, Canada, and Europe. The James Webb Space Telescope is your telescope. Use it to explore, to challenge theories, to see sights yet unseen. It's yours to unfold the beauty and mystery in the universe and our place in it.
So obviously, something that most of us are excited about, the current launch date is October 21st of this year, of 2021. So hoping that happens. Hope you enjoyed this introduction to telescopes. Feel free to research them a little more on your own. There's lots of resources out there. Thanks so much.